I'm Ross Galabrese, executive editor of the Herald Star and the Weirton Daily Times, and I'm joined today by Paul Gianamore, a longtime pundit at our newspapers, and we're going to be taking a look back at the year that was, 2013.
We will, Ross. We kind of went through and sort of, in our own way, selected our top choices for news stories of the past year. And in no particular order, we're going to present them to you now.
All right, Paul. Well, one of the biggest stories in our area in 2013 actually began in 2012 and is certain to stretch into 2014. Protests about the way the incident that would become known as the Steubenville rape case was handled were held in January in advance of the trial of Malik Richmond and Trent Mays, who were accused of raping a Weirton teenage girl following a series of alcohol-fueled parties in August of 2012. Both were convicted in March, and Mays also was found delinquent of illegal use of a minor and nudity-oriented material for having a picture of the 16-year-old victim in an outgoing text message on his cell phone. Almost immediately after those convictions were announced on March 17th, Ohio Attorney General Mike DeWine announced a special grand jury would be seated to determine if additional crimes had been committed regarding the case. That grand jury began meeting in April, heard testimony from 123 individuals, and reviewed evidence gathered by the Ohio Bureau of Criminal Investigation during 18 separate days, and returned indictments related to and unrelated to the case against the following: Steubenville City School Superintendent Michael McVeigh, Puglisi West Elementary Principal Lynette Gorman, Garfield East Special Education Teacher Seth Fluharty, former volunteer Steubenville High School football coach Matt Bellardine, and retired director of technology William Reinemann. Reinemann's daughter, Hannah Reinemann, was indicted on two counts of receiving stolen property and one count of theft related to her work as a contract employee for the school district. Court proceedings against all of those who have been indicted are scheduled to continue in January.
Of course, we'll be keeping you up to date on that story as it goes throughout the year to come.
Oh, certainly.
One of our other big stories in the area this year was at the Franciscan University of Steubenville, which inaugurated its sixth president, the Reverend Sean O. Sheridan, of the Third Order Regular of the Friars of St. Francis of Loretto, Pennsylvania, on October 10th. Sheridan sees the university's role as standing and fighting attempts by the government to violate Catholic religious beliefs and the ability to practice its faith through policies that increasingly foster standings against pro-life. As for physical plans for the school, Sheridan said he wants to see a larger chapel on campus, with the current Christ the King Chapel full for daily masses. Sheridan replaced the Reverend Terrence Henry, who now serves as chancellor of the university. Henry was president since 2000. Sheridan is a 1985 graduate of the University of Pittsburgh School of Pharmacy and worked as a pharmacy manager from 1984 to 1990, then went on to earn a law degree at Pitt in 1990, practicing law in Pittsburgh and Sacramento with a focus on health care litigation. He entered the Third Order Regular in the year that Henry was named the Franciscan University's president.
Paul, that's an exciting thing coming up for the university. I know you and I both had opportunity to spend a lot of time with Father Terry during his period here.
Yes.
And he brought a sense of energy to the university, and Father Sean seems like he's going to continue that, you know, certainly with his own style.
Absolutely, and you know, Father Terry used to always talk about the need to bridge the gap between town and gown, and we're starting to see some real results of that with the project these kids have going in the Odd Fellows building downtown, which we'll tell you more about as the days go by, but some good things happening there.
Great. All right, third on our list involves Amish beard cuttings. Samuel Mellett Sr. is serving 15 years in prison stemming from Amish beard cutting attacks in 2011, and he lost an appeal bid in July. Mellett was seeking release in a new trial, but the Sixth Circuit Court of Appeals said Mellett failed to prove he is not a threat to the Amish community in eastern Ohio. A total of 15 others convicted in the case were sentenced to between 1 and 7 years in prison. Mellett also was denied a release request in April when a judge dismissed a complaint from Mellett about being held in a Texas federal prison instead of one closer to his family. He was sentenced in February. The hair and beard cutting attacks had drawn national attention. Mellett was accused of coordinating the assaults that were motivated by religious intolerance. He was described as the leader of a breakaway Amish sect that settled in Jefferson County near Bergholz. Mullett saw the conduct of other Amish groups as being hypocritical to the tenets of his faith. And you know, Paul, that made our list, certainly because it happened very close to our own backyard, but I think it's interesting, too, that the editors from around Ohio who voted for the top stories in the Associated Press made that story one of the top stories.
You know, religious intolerance, even among people of the same sect, is just a major national story. Mm-hmm. You know, if you remember, we were seeing this on the national news when it was happening early last year. Sadly, a story of national interest in our backyard. Not one that we wished was there, but certainly an interesting one.
Right.
One of the more interesting things on the positive side for us in the area this year is the Jefferson County Port Authority, which finally has established some footing. It began the year working to replace Progress Alliance as the economic development lead agency in Jefferson County. It finally got around to hiring a director in November. During the first 11 months of the year, the authority established offices in the Jefferson County Air Park's Ralph Freshwater Terminal building and began working to solicit private donations to assist in its work of promoting and developing Jefferson County. The group began advertising in August, its first anniversary, for an executive director. Donna Rezzo, who had served in an assistant capacity at Progress Alliance, was named manager. Evan Skirty, son of former Jefferson County Commissioner Adam Skirty, was chosen as the Port Authority's first executive director in November. He worked for Ashland County and the Ohio Department of Transportation's Jobs and Commerce Office with the job of overseeing 11 northeastern Ohio counties. He was chosen from among 20 applicants. And of course, Evan had been kind of in the running in years past,
right,
for some of the economic development posts,
right,
here, and it's good to see him come home.
Yeah, and you know, I think that's important. I think it sends a message, because one of the big complaints you always hear from people who live in this area is that we raise our children, we educate them, and then send them off to all points of the country and in some cases the world, and the talents that they have to offer are lost.
And we're actually seeing a guy who's in charge of helping that to stop from happening coming right back to help that, you know, not happen. So it's
right,
a great thing.
It is a good thing. Well, Paul, let's look at the city for a minute.
We have to.
The city manager in Steubenville. Now, one place where the choice didn't go quite as planned in 2013 was in the finding of a new city manager for Steubenville. Following some changes in direction and opinion in the spring, city manager Kathy Davison resigned in May following 38 months on the job. She said it had become apparent that she and city council did not share the same vision for the city. Now, the city's been down this road before, with Davison being simply the latest in a line of city managers during the past 29 years to see the relationship with council turn sour. What happened next, however, was new territory. The city advertised for resumes and conducted interviews, eventually settling on a candidate in September, but that candidate turned down the city's offer for a job in Kansas. And that set city council to advertising again, while Mayor Dominic Mucci continued serving as interim city manager under terms of the city charter. Mucci went through the balancing of a budget shortfall that was greatly reduced, negotiating with city unions and dealing with the recreation department after it had gone nearly a year without a full-time director following the resignation of the previous director at the end of 2012. Now, the city's half year without a manager is coming to an end, with Timothy Boland, the town administrator of Pataskala, being hired as city manager at the end of November. Boland had served there for 7 years through three contract extensions. Now, Pataskala is a city of about 15,000 that is one of the fastest growing in the state, according to Councilman Greg Metcalf. Boland also had been planning and zoning administrator for Perrysburg and Powell, both in Ohio, two other successful communities. Now, city government also will be dealing with a relatively less experienced council in 2014, with senior councilmen Rick Perkins and David Pokey Lalich not seeking re-election. Lalich resigned at the end of November for pension reasons, and his replacement, Robert Villamagna, a retired Steubenville police sergeant, was named to fill the vacant seat early. Perkins will be replaced by city resident Michael Johnson.
There's just so much happening there. I mean, I'm taken back to when the charter first came into existence 29 years ago. There was a sort of thought back then that maybe, you know, members of city council weren't quite up on wanting to switch from the strong mayor government, and the very first manager they hired was a gentleman who had been city manager in Weirton, and as it turned out, he didn't meet the qualifications of the city charter, and they had to start all over again. That's back in 1984, but we've survived. It just is what it is.
Yeah, we've survived. And you know, while we're talking about the city, let's talk a little bit about the Charter Review Commission.
Yes.
You know, the charter has been in effect since when?
1984, the voters passed it.
1984, yes. The voters passed that. And the commission being chaired by Judge John Masseo,
who was law director back when the charter came into being. I don't think they could have picked a better person who's familiar with the city, familiar with the law, and has the city's best interests at heart. I think that was a great choice.
Right, it was. And they're working hard on changes, well, potential changes. There might be any changes. There might not be any changes. They may not come back with anything. Mm-hmm. But that'll be also on the horizon in the coming year.
It's just something that needs to be done periodically to make sure that the town hasn't changed so much that the rules that were written as the city's constitution no longer fit the bill. And so it's a good idea to take a look at that every few years.
All right, Paul.
We're going to turn to economic development, Ross. The area has, of course, been seeing this shale boom taking shape, with much of the year's action focused on Harrison County to our immediate west. Developments there included not just the drilling of more wells seeking to extract gas from the shale, but also the opening of Mark West Energy Partners' fractionator facility and rail yard near Caddis, as well as a facility called the Harrison Hub, a combined effort of three companies. The hub is the first integrated natural gas processing and fractionation complex serving producers in the Utica Shale region. So it's a big deal. We're becoming more and more of an energy center as the world advances with the shale energy. And while the drilling activities in Jefferson County haven't been quite as increased during the past year because we're told by the experts that the kind of gas that's available under much of Jefferson County isn't the high profit kind, and until some economics turn, probably we won't see the boom in drilling occurring here. There still are developments occurring in Jefferson County. There's lots of pipeline work being done to crisscross the county to service all these new facilities. And the area is also becoming a hub for related activities. You'll note that many vacant buildings in Steubenville now are occupied by companies in drilling services. And as part of that, to provide for the greater demand for motel rooms, Steubenville saw a new 79-room microtel open at 909 Buckeye Street, the former All-American Lanes area, overlooking the Veterans Memorial Bridge. The microtel opened in late November. Officials said the hotel is in a perfect position at the center of the shale plays in eastern Ohio, as well as being able to serve the adjacent Franciscan University of Steubenville. The city of Steubenville also saw a couple of other business developments during the year, with the opening of a new TJ Maxx store in the Hollywood City Center in October. The store had been nearly 2 years in the making. And also opening in the city limits was a new Texas Roadhouse in May at the Fort Steuben Mall.
Right, and you know, there... You talk with some people, and they're the naysayers. They say there's not a lot happening. But I think when you look at the overall picture of everything that has happened in the past year, year and a half, you see a very different picture. You see a picture of a community that is growing and is poised for more growth.
We may not have the holes in the ground, but the wallets are opening up of all those people who are here to both drill those holes and support the people who drill those holes. And we are seeing an increase. I mean, just driving down Sunset Boulevard, you're seeing more traffic now than you did a few years ago.
Right.
And it, you know, I'm starting to get stuck at the light at University Boulevard when I leave here in the afternoon. And it's, you know, it's a good feeling now to have that problem coming back.
Right. Yeah, there are some good problems to have. And certainly a little bit longer commute means that something good has happened.
And we all know our friend Mike Paprocki down at BHJ has all the plans on the table to fix that traffic light, and now I no longer feel the need to call Mike and say, why bother?
Yeah, you know, Mike has plans for that. We've seen University Boulevard resurfaced work, at least preliminary work on the Lover's Lane widening is supposed to start this year. All very positive things.
Good things that indicate we are ready for the growth that we think is occurring.
Right. Good. Well, from a happy story unfortunately, we did have sad stories in the past year. And one of the saddest happened on a quiet and rainy Friday morning in October, when a peaceful morning was shattered by a gas explosion that obliterated a house on Eldersville Road in Follansbee, claiming the life of 13-year-old Hannah Mazingo and resulting in the hospitalization of her mother, father, and a sister. Now, the gas leak had been reported shortly before the explosion. The blast shook residences in the immediate area, blowing debris across the street and into the treetops. The explosion was heard up and down the Ohio River Valley for miles. Much of the fall included a variety of fundraisers for the family, which lost nearly all of its possessions in the blast.
That is one of those news days that stands out and will be in my head and heart forever. We went into Ross's office that morning for our morning news meeting, as we do every morning, and we had our usual banter about what was going in the paper, and it was, you know, what Johnny Carson would have termed a slow news day. And before we sat down at our computers, I mean, the explosion is just something you don't forget hearing. And it was just a real, real shock.
It was. And while the story is sad, no doubt, I think if you look at the fundraisers and the support the family has received from our area, it once again shows one of the big strengths of our area.
The heart.
The heart.
Absolutely.
Very good.
And part of the heart of this area for a long, long time, 100 years, was the steel industry. And though things have changed dramatically in steel the last few years, something very positive happened in Beach Bottom at the old Wheeling Corrugating Plant during the past year. It's a great example of the ability to reuse local factories and industrial land and what the future could hold for us. The old Wheeling Corrugating Factory right off Route 2 in Beach Bottom saw the factory go back to work, back to use under the auspices of Jupiter Aluminum. Through private investment and the efforts of the Business Development Corporation of the Northern Panhandle, employees are back working in the plant in a new venture from its former use as a corrugated steel production facility. New equipment that has been installed allows custom orders for aluminum sheet, and plant officials hope to see an around-the-clock workforce sometime in 2014 with as many as 45 workers back on the job in what would have just been another vacant factory.
Yeah, and you know, Paul, that's another example. You know, we talked about Evan Skurdy taking the reins of the Jefferson County Port Authority. Beach Bottom and several other developments in the Northern Panhandle, I think we have to credit our good friend Pat Ford.
Two words, Pat Ford, no doubt about it. He came here with, you know, big city experience, and he's just a firebrand. He knows where to look, and he knows how to recruit, and we're starting to see the fruits of that. And I, you know, hope that that's the example of what stability in the economic development sector can actually bring to the area, and that we see that followed more and more.
Right. It's all positive. It's all positive, as Pat has maintained since he came here. Mm-hmm. Development in any part of the tri-state area benefits every part.
Exactly, and if they can work together as a team, we should just prosper.
Sure. Well, you know, Paul, one thing that it's easy to predict as we begin 2014 is the opening of a new school in the city of Weirton. Now, the new Weirton Elementary School, located just off Pennsylvania Avenue, has its principal, and the county school system will be naming teachers and staff to the building shortly, which is to be completed in March. The new school is being built because voters in Hancock County saw fit to invest in the future of the community's children. In Toronto, meanwhile, the investment by residents there has opened the new school, the new junior-senior high school building, which combines elementary through high school all in one two-building campus. The old Toronto High School, which served the community for a very long time, it has been torn down.
In the process of being torn down.
Right.
Drove by yesterday. There's still an awful lot of school standing
there. Okay, there's still a lot of school left. And you know, that's a positive thing. You know, it's good for a community like Toronto. I think it it's an example for the other communities in our area.
You know, where it's easy to be wowed by all of the new and shiny in a new school and the modern electronics and the way they hardwire these things for, you know, everything from the iPad to the computer workstations everywhere for the kids. Mm-hmm. One of the things that really impressed me was that designed right into this building is a reflection of the modern world. The security is literally part of the layout of the building, the way you get in, the way you get out, who you have to walk by, how you can get through, is all very, very secure. Mm-hmm. And it's just designed and engineered right into the building. Kind of amazed me when I saw that.
And we have those two new schools. And, of course, we can't forget that Indian Creek opened a new junior high school in Mingo Junction.
That's right. Yes. And that was a big, big operation years in the making for that district.
That was. You know, all positive for the young people in our area.
Absolutely. One story that we all kind of remembered from the past year that was just a fun story. I think anyone in the area who has ever heard the song Play That Funky Music knows that it originated with Rob Parisi of Mingo Junction and the group Wild Cherry. It's still receiving airplay nearly 40 years after it was recorded. And Parisi was honored by his hometown of Mingo Junction in August with a community celebration as part of the town community days. Parisi's kind spirit and generosity were lauded during a special banquet and also well displayed as he established an endowment for Indian Creek students. He played the group's hit, Play That Funky Music, during the Community Days Festival in August as part of the annual festivities there. And a former Rock and Roll Hall of Fame executive delivered the address honoring Parisi during his banquet. Play That Funky Music, in case you were wondering, peaked at number one on the Billboard R&B and pop charts in 1976, while the single and Wild Cherry's self-titled debut album obtained platinum certification. Wild Cherry was named Best Pop Group of the Year by Billboard and received an American Music Award for Top R&B Single of the Year, and also earned a pair of Grammy nominations for Best New Vocal Group and Best R&B Performance by a Group or Duo. So our fellows from Mingo, led by Rob Parisi, were a big deal when you and I were a little younger. I was going to say when you and I had hair, but that wouldn't bother you.
Right. It wouldn't bother me. You know, I can remember sitting in a dorm room in Athens at Ohio University in 1976 or early 1977, and you know, we had gathered to watch Midnight Special.
Oh, wow.
To watch Wild Cherry perform Play That Funky Music.
And I do believe that video shows up somewhere on YouTube.
I don't know
how legal or illegal its posting there is, but I know I've seen that on YouTube.
If it's on the internet, it must be true. It must be legal.
That would put us back a whole bunch of other stories we could tell. Let's not go there. You may have noticed, however, that Ross and I have spent the last few minutes with you with our special mugs with the Herald Star and Daily Times logo on them. And if you happen to like these, you can be sure to check them out, as well as other logoed newspaper items available in our new web store, which you may access through heraldstaronline.com.
Right. You know, it's a fun thing if you're looking for a nice gift for a person who lives in the area or who lives out of the area, you know, something fun for yourself. These mugs, Paul, our Fiesta wear.
Fiesta wear. I have my collection at home, and I'm glad to have one of these as part of it, too. Well, made in Newell.
Made in Newell.
The Homer Laughlin Company.
Right, exactly. So, the online store, you should check it out.
Absolutely.
Also, something you should check out as we head into 2014 is Paul and I will be doing news on a semi-regular basis.
We're planning on, you know, on the big news days at the very least, and maybe more regularly than that, coming in and having a seat here and giving you a news summary of the day, hopefully after the newspaper deadline. Mm-hmm. And we're excited about it. It's something we've had in the works since I came back in April. And I just think it's the future. I think that our ability to communicate in a more direct way with our readers, it's just exciting, you know.
Right.
Just really cool.
Something we're looking forward to. One other thing we're looking forward to, we're going to throw in a shameless plug here. We hope everyone will join us at 6 o'clock on January 16th when we produce the third annual webathon to benefit the United Way of Jefferson County. It's going to come from our newsroom again. It's right near the end of the United Way campaign, so there'll be a lot of activity, a lot of action, a lot of phone action as the United Way works hard to reach its goal.
It is not true that Ross will be donning a Karnak the Magnificent hat and I will be yelling, "Hi-oh," however. But I do look forward to that. That's always a fun event, and the telethon usually is a big success for the United Way.
It is. As a longtime board member of the United Way, it's one of our more successful evenings, and we have a lot of fun.
And I show my age by calling it a telethon. It is a webathon. Yes. We thank you for being with us today and hope we jogged your memories a little bit about the year that was, and we want to wish you a Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you, Paul.
Happy New Year, Ross. Good to be back.
All right. Good to have you back.
All right. The one-hit wonders, the one-take wonders strike again.
The one-take wonders strike again.
I tried not to laugh as you mooched out the word Pataskala. Through the end of the week, maybe.
All right.
Cool. This was fun.
All right, there you go.
Today's what, Tuesday?
We can only get better.
The first is...